What's going on, everybody? Our mob of Houston Ensemble, and we have a very juicy one for you today. Three times the fact checkers were wrong. Now, this is by no means the only three times, but these are the juicy ones that I thought of today. But before we get into it, please like, comment, and subscribe if you support what we do. It'll only take you a second, but it means so much to us. So let's jump right into it because we have a lot to go over. Fact check, USA Today. Hospitals get paid more if patients listed as rare and on ventilators. Now I'm gonna have to do that ridiculous self-censorship here, and you already know the reason why, but let's go to the punchline of this fact check. They rate true. We rate this claim that hospitals get paid more if patients are listed as rare and on ventilators as true. Hospitals and doctors do get paid more for Medicare patients diagnosed with MRAR, and if it's considered presumed they have MRAR, absent a laboratory confirmed test. Well, ain't that nice? Just skip the confirmation. Go ahead and give us the money. And three times more if the patients are placed on a ventilator to cover the cost of care and loss of business resulting from a shift in focus to treat MRAR patients. Well, they literally just plug it into your throat and let you die over several days. Nurses check up only when there's a signal to do so, but by then the severity of the situation is so bad, and we just have deaths. We have deaths almost always following ventilation. And how do I know this? Because it's on the NIH website, PubMed. Because it's on WMD study, most NY ramp patients on ventilators died. How about this? Case fatality rates for patients with ramp requiring invasive mechanical ventilation and meta-analysis. Really high statistical chances of death. They call it case fatality rate. So not only were people ridiculed for pointing out that there's a monetary incentive, but it actually leads to more deaths. It's almost as if they want people to die. Well, that can't possibly be the case, right? Let me read this other paragraph here. This higher allocation of funds has been made possible under the Aid, Relief, and Economic Security Act through Medicare 20% add-on and its regular payment of patients as verified by USA Today through the American Hospital Association Special Bulletin. You can go ahead and fact-check me, fact-checking them, fact-checking for yourself. Even in the Houston Methodist Hospital Protocol, this is very, very important, okay, because the devil is in the details, right? As I covered in my previous video on the Satanic Temple, which I highly recommend you watch. Look at this protocol statement. Does patient have any treatment disqualifying criteria, such as greater than 5 times or ULN or mechanical ventilation greater than 5 days? Look. If you're 4 days mechanically ventilated, they'll still give you this lethal substance, this lethal thing right here, which I also cannot say. So it is a death warrant on all accounts. On every angle of this 360 is your death warrant. How do I know? Once again, NIH, the name of this drug, which I cannot say. Acute renal failure, a potential safety signal from disproportionality analysis of the WHO safety database. So this is via NIH, through WHO, on PubMed, peer reviewed, okay? Go check it out for yourself. That's number one for you. But it just keeps getting better. Let's watch this clip real quick.
Gallier saying patients are packing southeastern Oklahoma emergency rooms, taking ivermectin doses meant for a full-sized horse, believing false claims it could fight COVID-19.
The ERs are so backed up that gunshot victims were having hard times getting to facilities where they could get definitive care and be treated.
Notice the really shifty body language. I'm not going to turn into a body language video all of a sudden, but I love the way he tells this story. Look at this.
19.
The ERs are so backed up that
Nice little self-consoling mouth fidget.
At gunshot victims were...
Gunshot victims looks immediately to the top left. That is a lie indicator.
Having hard times.
And again!
getting to facilities where they could get definitive care and be treated.
Something Miguel Ye says is now backing up small town ambulance systems too.
All of their ambulances are stuck at the hospital waiting for a bed to open so that they can take the patient in, and they don't have any, that's it. But there's no ambulance to come to the call.
Miguel Ye says many of his patients aren't even afraid of ivermectin, using it on their livestock. Now, they're going to their local ag stores, ignoring the warning signs, and figuring out a dosage themselves.
So some people taking...
How dare they do that? It's like, don't think for yourself. You can't measure stuff. You can't measure percentile of doses within the recommended amount per body weight. Like, no way. You didn't go to school for 15, 20 years of your life to do basic arithmetic and save your own life. Please trust this guy.
Inappropriate dosages have actually put themselves in worse conditions than if they had caught COVID.
Suffering nausea, vomiting, muscle aches, cramping, and that's only in minor cases.
The scariest one that I've heard of and seen is people coming in with vision loss.
Even the manufacturer saying there's no scientific or meaningful evidence that ivermectin is effective against the virus, but many store shelves still empty.
You have to ask yourself, if I take this medicine, what am I going to do if something bad happens? What's your next step? What's your backup plan?
That's Caitlin Ogle reporting.
So that's Oklahoma's news for, and I apologize for cutting him off so many times. I just get really in my feelings about this stuff sometimes. So I do apologize for that. And then we have, of course, Rachel Maddow covering it. So why is this important? Well, the hospital that fella was talking about issued a statement almost the next day. Let's read that statement. Message from the administration of Northeastern Health System Sequoia. Although Dr. Jason McElly is not an employee of NHA Sequoia, he is affiliated with a medical staffing group that provides coverage for our emergency room. Okay. With that said, Dr. McElly has not worked at our Salazar location in over 2 months. Am I crazy? But it gets better. NHA Sequoia has not treated any patients due to complications related to taking the thing. But all the headaches and the vision loss. What happened? He can't be lying. This includes not treating any patients for overdose. All patients who have visited our emergency room have received medical attention as appropriate. Our hospital has not had to turn away any patients seeking emergency care. So what happened to the long lines? We want to reassure our community that our staff is working hard to provide quality health care to all patients. We appreciate the opportunity to clarify this issue, and as always, we value our community support. Well, when the Rolling Stones covered the whole spin of it as being some sort of conservative stupidity scenario, they had to retract, and they made an entirely new article. One hospital denies Oklahoma doctor's story of overdoses causing ER delays for gunshot victims. Well, they can spin this as much as they want, but we've already got them. And why is this important? Well, once again, as easy as pie, you can go to the NIH website and see article after article after study on protocol treatment using this thing, how it's extremely effective, how they've used it for 40, 50 years. They've administered it to 4 or 5 billion people all over the world. And it goes on and on and on and on. Now, are we ready for the next one? Because it just gets better and better. Well, I was also going to point out, you know, if you want to make this video an hour and a half long, you can go to the funding sources. You can go into the chemical compounds that are being put into Pfizer's version of this thing that they're ridiculing, how it has one aspect of the compound and not the other. because all these antivirals are a combination of elements that work in tandem to be purposed as such. But we're gonna have to keep going, guys. So let's go straight into the big one. The one that I think is going to be the biggest criminal story on this planet in history. Let's get right into it. Polyfact retracts Wuhan lab theory, fact check. An awful lot of people in press were eager last year, maybe a little too eager, to dismiss the theory suggesting that the thing originated in a lab. They retracted it, but it doesn't stop there. I have a really juicy clip from CNN. Let's watch that. It's 8 minutes. I'm gonna have to get right into it. Let's just watch.
I want to continue our conversation with Dr. Francis Collins, the director of the National Institutes of Health. Dr. Collins, I want to talk about what has been making some headlines in the last few days. And what appears to be a major shift, the NIH now admits to funding risky research in the Wuhan lab years ago through EcoHealth Alliance, but just found out about this in August of this year. It's saying in a letter to Congress it was done in a limited experiment and that the mice became sicker with one type of a bat coronavirus compared to another type. In May, this is what Dr. Anthony Fauci declared.
Delicious.
The NIH has not ever and does not now fund gain of function research in the Wuhan Institute.
Do they fund
virology?
Dr. Barrick?
Dr. Collins, how could he say that when you're just now finding out that U.S. tax dollars were being used to pay for this risky research in that Wuhan lab 2 years ago? If you didn't know about what was going on, what else do you not know about?
So I'm glad you're asking, because this really needs to be clarified. Part of the confusion here, Pam, is this term gain of function. In common scientific parlance, gain of function involves all kinds of experiments where you're trying to understand the function of a particular biological cell. For instance, cancer immunotherapy, where we're trying to give people with cancer a chance to fight off their cancer by
activating. I just want to be clear. Sorry, Dr. Collins, I do want to interrupt because I think I want to be clear. I don't need to get into the nitty-gritty.
She's being savage on him.
About gain of function. This is to say, and I know it's manipulating a virus to make it more pathogenic, but this is to say that grant money was given to EcoHealth Alliance that was then conducting research in the Wuhan lab, and EcoHealth Alliance violated the terms of its contract by not immediately notifying the NIH of this risky research it was doing. You're just now finding out. So the question...
You're just now finding out. They're just now finding out. You see, if months ago they spin the story that it was not done in the lab, there was no funding, and then the same news network says, oh, there was, we're just finding out. You see, they knew the whole time, but they weren't being told, and then this and that. When your abuser shifts the entire blame, or when the liar shifts the entire blame to another character, you're not supposed to start believing then. A little light bulb is supposed to start going off in your head, just like if you were in a relationship with somebody and they were doing this to you, you would say, oh, there's a cycle of gaslighting and abuse here and misdirection. Maybe I should snap out of it real quick. Otherwise, I might be looking into getting a diagnosis for Stockholm Syndrome or seeing a therapist. But the whole clip is really long, so I'm going to keep going here. New York Post, NIH admits U.S. funding gain of rank in Wuhan despite Fauci's denials. And here is a letter from the principal deputy director of the NIH, Lawrence Tabak. I'm going to start reading from the bottom paragraph here. The research plan was reviewed by NIH in advance of funding, and NIH determined that it did not fit the definition of research involving enhanced pathogenic pandemic potential, because these had not been shown to infect humans. I'm sorry for the self-censorship. I just have to do it. As such, the research was not subject to departmental review under the HHS P3CO framework. And we heard about P3 CO before, years ago, from Mr. Antonio Falsley. However, out of an abundance of caution and as an additional layer of oversight, language is included in the terms and conditions of the grant award to EcoHealth that outline criteria for a secondary review, such as a requirement that the guarantee report immediately a one log increase in growth. Okay. And measures would prompt a secondary review to determine whether the research aim should be reevaluated or new biosafety measures should be enacted. Well, how convenient. See, oh, they're like, we actually were gonna look into it. Don't worry, we have a whole hidden clause where we can go right back into it and see what's going on there, huh? It's all legalese crap. And now they're issuing new statements about what is GOF? What does it actually mean to do this kind of research? See, well, we're trying to help you guys out. Okay, you see how it works? We messed you up. We killed you in the hundreds of thousands. We pre-released something and then we had a whole treatment ready for you when everybody was dying in the hospitals as per our own protocol and bulletin statements. And, but see, it's okay because we'll investigate it too and we'll clean it all up. So if you're doing an investigation on a criminal who led to the deaths of hundreds of thousands of people and even more today, you'd hire the criminal to do the investigation, right? You see how it works? And here's an email that we got from a lawsuit, a successful lawsuit by the investigative reporters at The Lancet. Look at this, really delicious. From 2014, May. Project title, Understanding the Risk of Bat Emergence. To Mr. Alexei, President, okay. Let me see here. Dear business official, the NIH hereby awards a grant in the amount of $666,000. Nice number. I really like that number. Very good stuff. So you can go ahead and read that for yourself too. Principal Investigator Peter Daszak, right there, name for you. Keep that name in your mind. And here's the Tracking Accountability Government Grant Reporting System, Understanding the Risk of Bat Blah Emergence, award number R01 blah 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 blah. Look at this. This is the $369,000 that they retracted after they got some flack for it. Then they gave it back. Then they gave an additional $733,000. Then they gave an additional $580,000. Then $590,000. Then $611,000. And it goes on and on and on. And so why is this all important? And I'm going to wrap up this video here. I did want to also go ahead and get into all of these authors. Like, I wanted to get into who Michael or Michelle Rogers is. I'm sorry. Maybe let's do a quick search right here. Michelle Rogers, USA Today, right? That was USA Today, right? Storytelling project. Let's see. What is this? What is her... I need a LinkedIn account to figure this out. Okay. I want to see her education. I just want to see her education. Bachelor's degree of journalism. Great. So she has a bachelor's degree of journalism. I maybe have to thank this person for admitting that it was true. But I also wanted to point out, she has a bachelor's degree in journalism, guys. So they're not hyper geniuses. They're not the arbiters of truth. They're not qualified to make scientific statements that you are not qualified to do. Trust in yourself. Trust in your intellect, trust in basic research skills, investigative skills. It'll all make sense clearer than you might suspect. This has been Houston Ensemble. Armoff signing out. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. It'll only take you a second, but it means so much to us. And I'll see you on the next video.
It is widely known that the tobacco and diet industries lobby governments with scientific propaganda for years until proven guilty in court. The artificial treatment of our water is the next corporate deception.
For example, virtually every nation in Europe has rejected the use of artificial fluoride. International studies since the 40s have repeatedly shown that endocrine and neurological effects increase after repeated consumption, even at the levels accepted by U.S. government.
Epic Water Filters is the most thorough, industry-grade filtration system that Houston Ensemble has ever used. They reduce heavy metals upwards of 99.5%, such as lead and mercury, bacteria like E. coli, and poisons like chromium, nitrate, and fluoride.
Join us in our journey to living a toxin-free life and get your Epic Water Filter using discount code Houston Ensemble, lowercase, one word. That's Houston Ensemble, lowercase, one word, for 20% off your Epic Water Filter.